Hey, good morning to Richland Creek. You guys, come on in, grab a seat. Excited to worship with you all today. Those of you all that are joining us online, thank you all so much for worshiping with us this morning. As you're getting settled in, maybe you want to grab a copy of the bulletin, see some of the announcement stuff going on here at the Creek. You can do that off the QR code on our side screens or on the screen if you're watching online. This morning, I'm going to be reading from Psalm 100, and it says, "Shout joyfully to the Lord, all the earth. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name, for the Lord is good. His loving kindness is everlasting and his faithfulness to all generations." Let's pray. God, we thank you for the fact that you are faithful to all generations, that your name will be great. God, even as we worship through song, through baptism, through the teaching of your word today, God, we pray that you would be exalted in all these things. Thank you for all that you're doing in our church and all the ways that you allow us to partner with you in fulfilling your mission. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're going to start our time of worship this morning singing songs of thankfulness, just like that passage was talking about. So let's stand together and let's worship.
Hallelujah, for all you've done.
may be seated.
Good morning, Richland Creek. Today we have a special day for us as we celebrate baptism. But before we celebrate baptism, just want to share a praise for all of you. As you've noticed over the last couple of weeks and even months, we've been blessed to see 47 individuals join Richland Creek in Covenant Church membership. Praise the Lord. You're going to see 5 new members joining today through baptism as their final step in the membership process, and then we'll have another 2 individuals joining at the second service. And so we just, again, rejoice and give God glory for bringing people into our family. And we're excited this morning to, again, celebrate baptism. For these believers, their baptism is a public proclamation of their faith. It symbolizes the life, death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. And as a church, we have the privilege this morning to witness their baptism and rejoice in this testimony of the gospel. So our first person being baptized is Miss Samantha Carroll. She's being baptized by Pastor Stephen, who's our student pastor. This is Samantha's testimony. My life before Christ was empty. I didn't understand what it was like to believe in God or truly love Him. I said I was saved, but never meant it in my heart. I didn't pray to God for forgiveness of my sins. I got saved at Overflow when Mr. Eric Garner preached. He was telling his life story, and it almost felt like he was talking to me. He was saying that he got saved when he was 9, but didn't mean it. Later in his life, he realized it wasn't true salvation, and that's when I burst into tears, realizing that I was not right with God. I felt like I could pray for hours apologizing to God. Christ is making a difference with everything, school, soccer, and day-to-day activities. Before, I would feel weird telling someone I'm a Christian, but now I want to go to Walmart and share the gospel and say that I'm a Christian. When I read the Bible, it's different. I try to feel the words instead of just reading. By being baptized today, I'm telling the world that I'm a Christian, a disciple, and that I love Jesus, and nothing will change that.
Personal Savior.
Yes.
Then it is my pleasure to baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk.
And next we have Miss Lucy Jacoby, who's being baptized by Pastor John Neota, our Associate Connections Pastor. My life before Christ, I was raised in church, I attended Christian school, and did my best to be a good person. I sincerely believed that doing good works would earn me favor with God. I trusted Christ when I started attending Richland Creek and started hearing the gospel presented in a very clear way. It was in the summer of 2012 that I realized all the good works that I counted on, I couldn't earn me my salvation, and that the only way to have a relationship with God and to be reconciled back to Him was by repenting and believing that Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection was for me. That day, I repented from my sins and asked Christ to be my Lord and Savior and surrendered my life to Him. Christ is making a difference in my life by giving me peace in spite of my circumstances. God has also taught me what true forgiveness is. I should forgive others as God has forgiven me in Christ. As a result, I have peace, and I have learned to let go of anger, resentment towards others who have wronged me. By being baptized today, I am telling the world that I am a child of God because He has forgiven me and has adopted me into His family. I have been redeemed by Jesus' precious blood, and He is all I need in life.
Okay, before I baptize Lucy, I just wanted to say that, as Pastor Cameron said earlier, we have some who are joining the church, and this is her last step. Lucy is taking her last step to be not just to her public testimony as a Christian, but also to join us as church family. Okay? Lucy, have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
Based upon your confession, my sister, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, buried in the waters of baptism, and raised to walk in newness of life.
Thank you.
Next we have Jamison Carroll, who's being baptized by Pastor John Wright, our operations pastor. This is the testimony of Jamison Carroll. My life before Christ was very difficult, filled with problems and uncertainty. I came to the knowledge that I had sinned against a holy God and I was personally under his wrath. I trusted in Christ when a ministry leader in Wyckoff, New Jersey, in 1992, as I realized that Jesus alone is the way, the truth, and the life. There is no other means of salvation except trusting in his death, burial, and resurrection. Christ is making a difference in my life because I am filled with love, with wonderful relationships in all aspects of life, and most importantly, a relationship with God. By being baptized today, I am telling the world that I acknowledge my faith and belief is in Christ alone.
Jamison is not only being baptized today, but through his baptism, it's his last step of church membership. So we rejoice in that today. These are your brothers and sisters in Christ, and I know they rejoice with you as well. Jamison, let me ask you today, have you placed your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior?
Yes, sir.
Based on your profession of faith, my brother, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in the waters of baptism, raised to walk in newness of life.
The work that God has done in these people's lives, and I know each one of us have a story too that know him of how God's transformed our lives. And so let's give them a hand again. Praise God for what he's doing. So as we continue our time of worship, we, those of us that know Christ, we have that assurance of who he is in our life. And we're going to sing Blessed Assurance. So please stand.
Thank you.
In the darkness, you are waiting without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. Through a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
If you have your copy of God's Word, would you turn to Acts chapter 17? Acts chapter 17, and we have much to be thankful for today at Richland Creek. What a wonderful day today it is. A nice cold morning. We finally have winter and fall here, but praise the Lord for what Brother Cameron shared earlier. Pastor Cameron talked about all the people that are joining and being baptized today. We're just so thankful to the Lord for that today. Absolutely. We have much to be thankful for, and in many ways, the Lord has blessed us with a great church body, and for many of you, you have served in our armed forces in different capacities, and I'm so thankful for those here that are veterans. And this past week, just a few days ago, we did celebrate on Veterans Day those who have served our country so faithfully and in so many ways. So I'd like to just take a moment. Before we do, if you are a veteran here, would you stand so we could recognize you and encourage you today? So thankful for each one of you, and so thankful to have you all at the Creek. And then one more thing I want to mention to encourage you and just give you an update along the way. As I mentioned a couple of months ago, and you are aware, we are in process of searching for a worship pastor. And so you maybe, if you're new or you're walking in for the first time today, even on our stage every single week, we're led by a group of individuals who work full-time jobs elsewhere. You even see Carla and those who are on the stage here are giving many hours over and above their full-time jobs to be serving and leading some worship. And so thankful for them carrying us through this season. But by way of update, we have been meeting as a pastoral body, praying through exactly what the next steps are for us as a worship pastor. We selected a group of five of our pastors off of that pastoral body to be searching for this next worship pastor, including myself, John Wright, Jason Hall, Gary Workman, and Stephen Moy. And so we've been searching for several months now, by way of update the other day. And so we're not at the stage yet to be able to bring a name or anybody to you, but just be praying for us as we have come down on one candidate, as we are in the final stages of interviewing and our pastoral body having these conversations. Just be in prayer for us, and I want to give you an update that things are progressing, even though we can't come in here and give every step along the way. But be in prayer for our pastoral body and for this candidate as well, for possible worship pastor here at the Creek. And so pray for us in those steps in the days ahead. Now, if you've turned to Acts chapter 17, we're in a unique part of the book of Acts today where Paul walks into this city of Athens. And in fact, he's there by himself. And as he's in this city, he walks around and he sees all these, you know, images and false gods and idols. And it's a city of philosophers, people who think they know about God but actually do not. And so as he walks around this city, it provokes his heart. This message wells up inside of him to speak to these Athenians about how they can know this God. Now, I thought of this passage as we come up on Thanksgiving and we think about our culture and how they come to thank something. We should want to point them to the same God Paul points them to here in Acts chapter 17. So if you have your copy of God's Word open, would you please stand in honor of the reading of His Word? And I'm going to read just a couple of verses 22 and 23, but we'll be working our way all the way down through His sermon here that He gives here in Athens. But I want to begin reading in Acts chapter 17, starting in verse 22. The Word of God says, "So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, 'Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, "To the unknown God." He said, "What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you." Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Heavenly Father, we ask that you would use us as proclamation. We could walk around to proclaim your glory and greatness to this world. Lord, even today as we read this passage, that as we walk in this room, may we behold your greatness, and out of that may it come worship, thanksgiving, and gratitude to you alone. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated. As I mentioned, it's cold this morning, is it not? Woke up, a little ice on the windshield if your car was outside. I might not be able to say that at the second service right there. Ice might have melted. But we were up early. When you wake up on a cool fall morning like this, I enjoy the fall, winter time of the year as we transition. It's the orange and red. I mean, you just ride around right now. It's just beautiful outside, is it not? You can see so many trees and how beautiful it is. And for some of you, the big transition is, you know, you can get a pumpkin spice latte at the Starbucks. Anybody with me? I don't know. Some of you maybe not. I don't order them. They're not for me. But this is a different time of year. And as we approach Thanksgiving here in a couple of weeks, it's an interesting thing to be a Christian or not a Christian at Thanksgiving. Now we celebrate Thanksgiving. It's not really a Christian holiday like Christmas is. We're not remembering something in the Christian faith. But giving thanks is a part of being a Christian. Albert Moeller, who's the president of Southern Seminary, points out that Thanksgiving is a deeply theological act. He says, giving thanks is something we do to God. And as we give thanks, God is in our perspective. But one of the things that Dr. Moeller points out when he looks at Thanksgiving is he looks at the culture and he says, you know what? We as Christians give thanks to God. He says, but if you're an atheist, if you don't believe God exists, who do you thank? Certainly you can be thankful for those in your life who are caring for you. Maybe if you're a child and your mom and dad take care of you, they provide for your needs. You say, thankful for that. Or someone who buys your meal or does something physically for you. But your thankfulness is limited to what someone can do that's a person. But think about all the other gifts you've been given, your life and breath and everything God has given. You always wonder when a person who's not a Christian comes upon Thanksgiving, who are they thanking? Who are they coming before the Lord and saying, who are they coming every day at Thanksgiving saying, Lord, thank you for this, is what we say, but what do they say? So when Paul comes upon this city here that is of philosophers who think they have it all figured out and they're pursuing all of these different truths and they're the smartest ones out there. He walks through and he sees all these false gods and he exchanges with them and talks back and forth thinking about what is it that they're actually learning and knowing. They prided themselves in what they knew, much of like our world prides itself in the knowledge that we have. And so, just the same way Paul approaches this lost group of Athenians, and he goes and shares the gospel with them, I hope today as we study his sermon, this speaks to us. As we live out as Christians in the midst of this Thanksgiving season, we want to do the same thing, is point people to the Lord. Look how he does it here in verse 22. So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, he said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way, you are very religious." They're very spiritual people. And look how he sees it. He says, "For as I passed along and I observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar." So as he sees the streets, he's walking around, he says, you all are thinking about spiritual things. You have a desire to devote your life to something. And so Paul builds a bridge. He says, I see where you're at. I'm going to build the gospel over to you. I want to speak to what you're wrestling with. And he says, he found, look there in the text of verse 23, he says, I found also an altar with this inscription. It says, to an unknown God. They were so worried about catching all the gods, they thought, well, we may not know the names of these gods, we'll just make a fill-in-the-blank one, right? They said, just an unknown God. They just said, we'll just fill in the blank. Whatever God might be out there, we'll make an altar to him and hope we catch all of them. It's this general worship that is placed on nothing, right? So they're worshiping something that they don't even know if it exists. The same for our culture today. As we go into Thanksgiving, we're thanking something, and many people don't even know if God exists. I was looking at some Thanksgiving sayings. I was like, what does our culture say about Thanksgiving? And I found one. It said this: Thanksgiving Day is one fine opportunity to shower your love and gratitude on the whole world. So for their perspective, all the thanks stays right here in this globe. It stays in our world because there's no God to thank. It's just sentimental gratitude. I don't know if you think about this as you get together with your family in the holidays and they talk about being thankful. Have you ever thought about, are they actually thankful for the things God provides? So then Paul says, you may not know this, but let me tell you. Look at the text. He says, what therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. He says, I'm going to tell you who you should worship. I'm going to tell you who that blank is. I'm going to tell you that this is the real God. Because we thank God as believers because he is the greatest giver and the greatest gift that was ever given. So that's what we as Christians do. We have God that we look to. And so I want to just walk through his sermon, point to God, how we should be thankful for him, and how we can point our world to be thankful for him. So here's the first thing I want you to look at, is we're thankful for our Creator God. We're thankful for our Creator God. The first way where Paul starts his sermon is with creation. Look at verse 24. He says, the God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth. He says, before I start anywhere else, I'm going to start all the way back at creation, that everything that you see that is made, God made it. Even beyond that, he says, he rules over it. He's the Lord of heaven and earth. Can you imagine Paul walking through this town and seeing all these other images and idols and false gods, and it starts to well up in his soul, and he's supposed to cry out, hey, no, these are not where you need to be placing your worship. Look to the Creator God. That's what should happen to us, right? As we walk through our world, as you sit at work, as you sit at school, as you walk through Walmart, wherever you are at, you should have a desire to say, let me tell you about the Creator God. Don't worship all these other things. Look what he says about him. He says he does not live in temples made by man. You see, this Creator God is bigger than what we see in front of us. It's not something that man can make. And in a world now where our technology is advancing and our abilities as man have really come along, even then what we build doesn't come close to who God is. And he says, there is no temple which our God lives in. You know, my kids, when they were real little, we bought these couches at the house. They're kind of those oversized giant couches or the bigger ones. And they had the cushions on them that come off. And I didn't think about what that would mean for my household with the cushions came off. But what that means, not so much anymore, they're a little older. What that meant for several years is every day the cushions became a pile in the middle of the floor. Typically a fort. They were the ones you sat on were pretty stiff, and so they would build walls and a top to them. And so there's often times you couldn't even sit on a couch in the living room because of the kids building these forts. But we'd have this fort in the house. And so think about in your home how ridiculous it would be if you came in, you got a stack of cushions, and I looked at my kids and I say, let's live in there. That's where I'm going to live. You go, no. You live in the whole house, right? You don't live in this little pile of cushions. In the same way, when you look at God, you say, can we build anything that would fit God? No matter how smart of a computer we build, how smart of a phone that you have in your pocket, there's nothing that's going to come close to the greatness of our God. So we're not thankful for all these other things here. We can be thankful, but we should be thankful for our God. And that's why when Paul begins sharing the gospel, as we should walk into our culture today, as you sit down with somebody in work and you go say, let me tell you about my God, we begin with a creator God. We need people to see this is the God of all the universe. He is our creator God. And so when we come to thank God, we don't just thank him for a few things, we thank him for everything that he's done. And my wife's a pretty good cook. And so at the house, she plans the meals. She'll go to the store and buy the food for dinner, and then she'll cook it. And inevitably, right about dinner time, I come in, and I'll usually make, let's say I make sweet tea for dinner, right? I'll come in, make the drink. Of course, sweet tea, that's the only kind, right? There's no other. And so we make tea for dinner, and then we sit down at the table, and my kids see the very last minute me come in, I make the tea. And then mom's done all this work for dinner. And my kids sit down, and when they say thank you, they go, hey, thanks, Dad, for making the tea. Right? There was a whole lot of work gone into that. And then I swoop in, and they say thank you somehow to me at the last minute. And I say, listen, let me tell you what your mom's done. The same way here, if we're just thankful for those few little things, hey, I'm just thankful for a couple of friends, or maybe just the things people do for us, we have missed all the things that our Creator God has done. And so we need to look at our world, and even for us, to be able to say, God, thank you so much for everything you've done for me. But it's not just because he's a Creator God. Here's the second thing I want you to see. We're thankful because our God is a self-sufficient God. He's self-sufficient. What do I mean by that? He doesn't need anything. Doesn't need anybody or anything. Look at what Paul says in verse 25. He says, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. So if we can't build him a temple, he certainly doesn't need us at all. Look at what he gives us. He gives us life. That's what we should be thankful for, right? The fact you're alive and sitting here is because of the Lord. He gives you and I the breath we breathe. The air and the lungs, that's all him. That's not you. That's not the doctor. That's God himself. He's the one providing it for us. So if he does that, he's the one doing it. He doesn't need anything from us. He's the one providing for us. Now, this is a dangerous thing you show up in the church. You'll hear sometimes, I think preachers wander into this, and they begin to talk about how much God loves us, and then they shift over into this world where they talk about how God needs our worship. That's not true. While it is wonderful that we worship him, but you might say he needs our worship. Sometimes people might say he needs your service, how you serve him in the area of the church. He needs your money, your giving. He needs you. God doesn't need anything from us. He is self-sufficient on his own. Now, we get the privilege of worshiping him, serving him, giving to him, but that's a privilege. He doesn't need us. In fact, you say, well, he needs us for companionship. Even within the Trinity, here's a little piece of theology for you today. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit. He even has fellowship within himself. Doesn't need us for that. Wayne Grudem says it like this when he talks about who God is. He said, the difference between God's being, and our being, who we are, is more than the difference between the sun and a candle, more than the difference between the ocean and a raindrop, more than the difference between the Arctic ice cap and a snowflake, more than the difference between the entire universe and the room that we're sitting in. God's being is qualitatively different, not quantitatively different. It's not an amount. He's of a different kind, and he does not need anything from us. Since we're pressing into theology today, I'll give you a word that you can learn about the attributes of God. We call this the aseity of God, A-S-E-I-T-Y, that he is self-sufficient. He does not need us, like we're doing him a favor. Now, why is that important for our thankfulness? Let me flip it over here. That means God's faithfulness to me and you is not dependent on us. So when you wake up today, it's not as if God is dependent on something else in order to be faithful to me and you. That's why he can make promises that we can't even make. I'm dependent upon the gas in my car and my car to get me somewhere. I'm dependent on these lungs to work to be able to speak to you right now. I'm dependent on all kinds of things in my life. Even some days, I'm just dependent on my mind. You may feel this, you know, sometimes we wake up tired, grumpy, lazy, frustrated, down, depressed, whatever it might be, as those press in on our lives. Guess what? God isn't waiting on you for his faithfulness. He's faithful no matter what, because God is self-sufficient. He's able to operate on his own. So he says, let me look at these gods in our culture. And here's Paul looking around. He says, listen, to all these gods, you don't have to depend. These will fail you. But our God, he is completely self-sufficient. Let me give you a third thing we should be thankful for. We're thankful for our, and listen to my term here, designer God. What I mean by this is our God who makes things in such a wonderful way. He made us. He is a designer of wonderful things. Look at verse 26. He says, this is the God who created everything, doesn't live in temples that you look at. Look what he says, verse 26. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth. He says, from God, he made Adam, and we all come from Adam. He's not some localized God that's just only for people that live in North Carolina. He's the God of all the universe. So you sit here in this town, you may say, well, you're bringing your God from another place. No, no, no. This is the God who started it all. He's the one who created everything. Look at verse 28, what he says. In him we live, we move, and we have our being. As even some of your own poets have said, notice he quotes them, for we are indeed his offspring. He says, listen, you're kind of getting somewhere. You don't have it. And this is what he gets at. He says, verse 29, being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being, if you're going to say you're God's offspring, then the divine being is not like gold or silver or stone, or an image formed by art or the imagination of man. He says, if you think you're like God, then he's certainly not going to be some sort of computer or some sort of image that we made. God is going to be something greater than who we are. So when God made Adam, he made us and Adam in his image. That means we bear some of the traits that he has. Love, kindness, speech, thinking, relationships. These are all marks of being made in the image of God. We bear his image. This is a glorious truth of thanksgiving that not only has God given us breath, but when we breathe, when we speak, we're mirroring our Creator. Our value and who we are is found in the value of who he is. You know, there's a famous story. When we moved here 6 or 8 months ago from Charlotte, and we lived on the east side of Charlotte. And if you've been down to the east side of Charlotte, there's a gold mine that was found out there. It's called Reed's Gold Mine. Many of you maybe have been to it. But it's famous because that area, there was quite a bit of gold that was discovered. But the famous story was in 1799, early on in America's history, where John Reed had a son named Conrad. Well, Conrad was down at the creek one day, and he found this big, shiny gold rock. It was 17 pounds of gold. But he didn't know what he had. Took it back to the house, and the famous part of the story is it was a doorstop for 3 years. Literally left it as a doorstop in the house, not knowing the value of this nugget. 3 years later, he takes it to a jeweler. The jeweler in Fayetteville supposedly paid him $3.50 for this 17-pound nugget. You say, well, that was inflation. In fact, that was only 0.1% of the value of it even at that time. You see, they didn't know the value of what they had in that gold. Paul says, you know what? You're worshiping all these false gods. But let me tell you that there's this wonderful God, and you're made in His image. And you don't understand the value you have until you understand the value of your God. He connects it all to them. You know what you have to be thankful for today is that we're actually made in the image of our Creator. We don't have to trump up some sort of false self-esteem that somehow I'm valuable because I'm smart or somehow I'm valuable because of something I do. You're valuable because you reflect the glory of God, because you were made in His image. So as you point others to what to be thankful for, in order to have real thanks, they've got to see the mirror image that they are of the Creator God that they're made in the image of. So today, we have much to be thankful for in our God. Here's the fourth thing I want to point you to, is we're thankful for our sovereign God. There's a level in which God is leading and guiding our world that we can trust in. You know, especially if you watch the news for more than 15 minutes, this is a good point for you to hear today. Look what he says to these Athenians about his God. He says, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place. So here he is. This is the God that has determined the boundaries for our world. That means he decides how far the sea goes, how far the land goes. He looks around and is sovereign even over the borders of our cities, our states, and our nation. He decides how tall the mountains are and how deep the valleys are. He sets the limits on your property lines and even the limits on our bank accounts. He even sets the boundaries in your life, does he not? Some of us have reached boundaries in height somewhere along the way. You found that God is going to only make you so tall. Can't control how that is. Maybe some of us, as I'm starting to feel at 42 years old, that God is retreating the boundaries on maybe how far your hair goes on your head. You feel the receding boundaries there. But you learn pretty quick that you don't control this world. You can feel it in your body. You can see it in your life. Because we worship a God who is the one who leads and is sovereign over all creation. Aren't you thankful that you have a self-sufficient God that is watching out for you day to day? That you can, amen, praise the Lord for that. Even as you look at, I'm just telling you, you go watch the news, you deal with your day to day, you need to go back and see, this is the one who's setting the boundaries. You have to trust the sovereign hand of God. Let me give you a fifth thing he says here. We're thankful for our knowable God. He says you can You can know this God. Now, there's a way to know him. There's a way not to know him, and there's a way to know him. And this is where he starts getting to the gospel. You have to read with me here and see exactly what he means. Notice what he says here in verse 27. He says that they should seek God and perhaps find their way toward him and find him. He says maybe they could find God. The problem is it's really hard for us to find God. The Bible describes us as blind people. You know, I once was blind, now I see, right? The Bible describes us as dead people. I once was dead, now I'm alive. Even Romans chapter 3 talks about this, where it says no one understands and no one seeks after God. So what does he mean when he said perhaps they could seek God and find him? What does he mean? As if they could grope in the darkness, that they might feel their way toward him? What does he mean by this, that it's possible for them to be able to find God? You see, sin works as a blinder. Now, there is one way to God, and there's another way we're never going to make it. If our way to God is by us living a good enough life, by our own abilities, that somehow I'm going to do something that gets my way back towards God, I'm never going to find him. I don't stand a chance. Just a few weeks ago, we were at Linville Caverns, which is up in the mountains. My family, we went down and walked through the caverns, and when you walk through there, they do something with you that you don't get to experience elsewhere about halfway through. This wasn't my favorite part of the tour, but they did it anyway. They turn out all the lights. So you're down deep in these caverns. They say this is where you can actually experience true pitch black darkness. Because normally there's a little bit of light seeping through the room. And so they say, you know, you turn out the lights and you hold your hand up right in front of your face and you can't see a thing. And so they talk about people that got deep down in those caverns and they have to find their way out. They're like groping through the cave. See, this idea that we're deep in sin and we're trying to find our way, but there's no way out. So then how is it that we're going to find God? What will it be that will lead us to this great God? As we wander through our sin, notice what he says there. He says, yet he is actually not far from each one of us. I know you may have a hard time finding him, groping through your sin in this world. He says, actually, he's not far. He says, let me tell you how he's not far. Here's the sixth thing I want to point you to, is we're thankful for our just God. You see, our God is just, but he is patient. Notice this, what he's done here in verse 30. He says, the times of ignorance God overlooked. So God knew we were in this world, in our sin, we're wandering through this sin. We can't see. And it says God overlooked these times. And then what it means here is not that God somehow like forgot about it. Their ignorance is the ignorance of an unknown God. They're seeking. And so maybe they're on the path. The Lord's bringing them along. But notice, it's not that he doesn't notice it or he maybe excuses it, but it's because he is merciful to us that he withholds his judgment. And Paul says here he's close, but be patient because there is a time his patience wears out. Look at verse 30. He says, the times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands. He says, it's no longer going to be optional. All people everywhere, that means of all of creation, he says, they're going to have to repent. That means turn from their sin. Because he has fixed a day, there is a definite day ahead of us right now, on which he will judge the world in righteousness. This is where we have a just God. He's not just going to let justice fall, and he's going to do it by a man who he has appointed. This is the Lord Jesus Christ. We repent from our sin and we turn to Christ. So there's a day coming in which God's going to judge this world. He's not going to keep overlooking our sin. Now, when I was in school, I like to procrastinate my work assignments. You know, you might get a paper, it's 3 weeks out, and you think, I got plenty of time, right? Turning that paper, that's far away, right? And then somehow, the day before, I think, oh, wow, I got that paper to do, right? There's a level of, you might think today, God's judgment for my life is far away. I'm not worried about that. Paul says, there's coming a day when God's no longer going to have the patience he does with you today. Judgment will come for us all. But then he gives the ray of hope. Here's the last thing, the seventh thing, is we're thankful for our Savior. If you don't know what to be thankful for here at Thanksgiving, it's of the Lord Jesus Christ. Notice he didn't just jump to Christ in his gospel. Here he went from God, he creates everything, he's made you, he's made you in his image, and he is the one who you're wandering through this life looking for something more meaningful, and as you search, there's a just God who stands here, his judgment is coming, it's a day that's ahead of you, and before that day you must repent, and then he points to Jesus. Look at this last part of the verse, he says, and of this he has given us to given assurance to us all by raising him from the dead. That's Jesus. He says, let me tell you about the hope you have in the day of judgment and what you should be thankful for. Now, he can't even finish his sentence, right? When he does this, the place erupts. The resurrection and the Lord Jesus Christ becomes the controversial point. That's where you and I, when we stand and our culture today, and we say, what are we thankful for? It might be okay to say, I'm thankful for God. But when you start saying, I'm thankful for Jesus and him saving me from my sins, that's when things start to happen. That's when the controversy shows up, right? And so in the same way here, we're pointing people to Jesus and saying, we're so thankful for him. Now, when Paul finishes this sermon, the crowd erupts, and there's three groups. And this is how I want to end today. I want to ask you, of these three groups, where do you fall? When you hear about the Creator God and the Savior God, where do you fall with him? The first group, scoff at him. Look at verse 32. He says, now when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked him. They did pretty good along the way, but when it came time to talk about the gospel, they began to mock him. Now, maybe if you're at church today, maybe watching online, mockery is not something you think of what you do. But I do know that sometimes you come with a person to church. Maybe you came with a parent. Maybe you're a teenager or you're watching online and you're sitting in the room and you can hear my voice and maybe you weren't intending to listen to this sermon. But in your heart, this is where you sit today. When you hear about Jesus the Creator and Jesus the Savior and Jesus the Judge, you think, man, I don't believe that stuff. Your response is like these that mocked. There's a second group here. He says, some were curious. He said, but others said, we will hear you again about this. So there are others who are in a journey, and that might be you today as well. You've been listening. You're seeking. You're wanting to know the truth, and you're on a journey to want to believe something. And you start to see God's hand at work, and so you're curious. You want to know more. I think it's a wonderful place to be. The only caution I would give you is he'll say about these Athenians, he said, you're always wanting to learn, but you're never wanting to arrive at a conclusion. And maybe you've been a philosopher your whole Christian life, and you got questions about everything, and the whole time you've been around the church, all you do is question, but you never want to come to a conclusion. Here's my warning today, that there will be a day that will conclude this life, and will you have the truth? Don't spend this whole life just questioning. You need to come to find Jesus. In the final group here, notice what happened in verse 33. So Paul went out from their midst, but some men joined him. They believed, and among whom these were Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with them. So these two individuals, along with others, notice what they did. They joined him, and they believed. That's the response to this gospel call. In order to have something truly to be thankful for, you have to join Christ. You have to trust him, repent of your sin, and believe in him today. And then all the promises of the Bible come alive, and you have something to truly be thankful for. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. So as we pray, I don't want you to check out right now. I don't want you to take your mind somewhere else. I want you to do something for me. I'd like for you in the quiet of this moment, I want you to thank God for something. Just in your seat. What has God provided for you today? We just went through a long list. Now, what you were thankful for, I want you to thank him for Jesus. The fact that he made a way for you to know him. Then I would ask you to do one thing in your mind. I want you to answer that question I posed. Most of you, I believe, here will say, I believe. But are you mocking now? Are you curious or do you believe? I want you to answer it in your mind where you're at. You may say you don't know today. But where are you at in response to the gospel and God himself? It said they believed and they followed. That means they joined the work of God. That means some of them joined the church right there. You saw that? They joined Paul. So today, maybe that's what you got. Your step is joining a church. You saw several people come do that today. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for all the many gifts you give us. And Lord, we pray you would give us grateful hearts. We would bring you praise and glory with our lives. We pray all these things in Christ's name. Amen. There's pastors and leaders down front that would love to pray with you and talk to you if you need to profess your faith in Christ, if you're wrestling with these questions, if you need some help working through some bitterness in your heart, you're not thankful or you don't have gratitude, whatever it might be, we'd love to talk to you and pray with you today. They'll be down front. You can just step out of your seat and come talk to them. If you'd stand and sing, respond to the Lord today.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace.
Amen, guys. You can be seated for just a moment. Thank you, Carla, for leading us today. What a special day it has been in the Lord's house as we celebrate baptism and as we consider these truths about who God is. I want you to know that you just went to a theology class this morning as we consider these attributes of God. You know, this is what anchors us in the storm is when we know these truths about who God is. And so, center those in your life and in your heart and know that he is with you at all times. And as we conclude today, I just want to point us forward to next week. We celebrated baptism today, one of the ordinances of the church. We'll also celebrate communion next week, the Lord's table. And so prepare your hearts this week. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, we're told that we ought to examine ourselves before we come to the table. So in preparation for next week, as we partake of the bread representing the body of Christ and the fruit of the vine representing the blood of Christ, and we remember together as a church family what he has done for us, come prepared and examine yourself this week so that we can come to the table, as it has been said, with clean hands and a pure heart, thankful for the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. As we depart today, we'll pray here in just a moment, but I also want to remind you that ushers are at the doors as you leave if you want to give your tithes and offerings as you leave. And for those who are doing that electronically online, thank you for your faithfulness to all who continue to support the gospel as it goes forward from Richland Creek. And then the most important thing as we leave is there'll be folks down front. If there's a burden on your heart this morning, something that maybe you didn't come forward during the invitation, but you would still like to speak with, pray with someone, we're here. We want to make ourselves available. So as others are leaving the room, you come forward. Let us know how we can come alongside you in the burden that you might be carrying today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, and we'll be dismissed. Father, we are thankful for who you are. Thankful that we can see these truths from your word. Your word itself is true, and it sanctifies us. It grows us. It sets us apart for your worship and your glory. And Lord, as we ponder these things in this season, may it not just be this season, but may it be all of our lives where we resonate with the truth of who you are. You are our creator. You are self-sufficient. You are a just God. You're also a gracious God, and you are our Savior through the person and work of Jesus Christ. So send us out now, anchored in those truths, but also proclaiming those truths to a lost and dying world. We thank you. We love you. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.